Welcome to the Fight Podcast with Jake and Nicci Hamilton,
where we discuss the complexities of marriage and manhood through real, raw, personal stories. All right, so we had to stop our last podcast because we didn't even get to the topic. We got a little distracted, thanks to me. Sorry.
Well, I think it's good. I mean, we just these podcasts are for us to be able to discuss some of the things that we're processing, hopefully that you're processing, and it gives you some things to think about when it comes to God, your life, the church, your story, your family, like how you're living, how you're embodying and inhabiting your own story. And that, I mean, that last podcast was just us being able to process some things that we were processing. So I think it's really
well,
valuable.
Yeah, we haven't had a lot of time to talk because you've been gone, which is why we wanted to, although I can say we have been doing a much better job of talking while you're on the road.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, like I said before, I used to not want to talk to you because I was just sort of pretending you were dead. You can't talk to the dead. You know, we're not, we don't believe in that.
No, we don't. Actually, let's not even go down that road. We don't.
So
we don't.
I couldn't talk to you.
So you couldn't talk to me. And so, but now you can.
Yeah, I can.
Because we have phones and we found a rhythm.
We always had phones, but I was just more like, I can't even deal with the fact that you're gone and you're living this life. And here I am feeling like I'm dying at home. But I'm better now. So
I'm better now. All better. Yes. There's not a trace left.
No, I'm not all better, but I'm working on it. Every day. I'm better. So this is what I wanted to talk to you about is your trip. First of all, you had a really cute encounter with our son who was home. So Jake got home at 11:30 at night.
Yeah.
And if you know me, you know that the most important thing to me in the whole wide world,
really?
I mean, it's right there up with my love for you and my love for our children, is my
love for sleep.
Yeah. And my value of sleep, because we are not functional human beings if we don't get enough
You're
sleep.
You're in bed by 9. We all get it. It's fine.
It's not just me. People say, here's the thing. For years, you would say, and you do, okay, preface that with the fact that you actually don't need nearly as much sleep as I do. No. I'm like an solid eight hours. That means, I mean, I have to be actually asleep for 8 hours. Yeah. You are okay with 5 or 6.
Yeah. I can survive. If I need to get stuff done, I can survive if I'm traveling on 4. Then it's that 5 or 6 though. Like 6 is optimal for me. 6 is 100%. I can function and I can do all I need to do.
But this is the thing. If you don't get that, even that amount of sleep, and you say that, but you're really no fun to be with if you have 4 hours of sleep.
No, I'm not saying, no. You're I didn't say I was fun.
Okay, so you can't say that you can, I can function. I'm going to be able to get up. I did that for years.
I have to go to work. That's what I'm saying. I think
I have to go to work. I had to go to work too, taking care of your 3 children.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so. But I am not the best version of myself.
Absolutely. That's what I'm saying.
Who is not trying to be the best version of themselves every day? I know.
You don't get that right every day. Sorry.
I'm always trying to be my best self all the time.
I guess all I'm trying to say is that I
another
get stuff
tangent.
Done.
We need to get
this. I get stuff done on 4 hours of sleep.
We
but
need to stop
I need
these
6
stupid tangents.
And you need 8. Yeah, got
okay.
it. So everybody
Anyways,
go
so
listen to the
son-
Huberman report on sleep and you'll be fine.
So that was such a ridiculous tangent just to say that I had to have our son go pick
literally.
You up.
That was the whole point.
Yeah, I had to have our son go pick you up at the airport.
Yes, because you were already asleep at
11:30. I'm not going to be able to function.
You're driving.
No, I will. No. Then I'll be grumpy the next day. I won't be my best self for you.
Aw.
So anyways, so he picks you up and he said something cute on the way home.
Well, it was just funny because, you know, we live in sort of even the tangent from the last podcast was us basically going like we live in kind of a big church culture, hype culture, like as a church as a whole, you know, I mean, like pretty worldwide, everything's celebrity, hype, big, it's all whatever. And it's got to be these, you know, the most crazy stories all the time, social media and a whole thing. And so we get in the car and he's like, Dad, what's the craziest thing that happened? And I was like, and first I'm already tired. I've been traveling for
20
hours. God only knows, you know? And I'm like, what? Like the craziest thing that happened. And so at first I'm like, am I answering this question? What am I? Okay. What was the craziest thing that happened? Now I'm trying to make stuff up in my head, you know, like going like, what is the craziest thing that happened? And I realize like, well, I don't even know what he means by crazy. So I'm like, what do you, like, dude, what do you mean by craziest thing? And it was honestly super funny because he's like, well, like, what kind of crazy healing, deliverance? Did like demons come out? Did people like fall out? Did this happen? And I'm thinking to myself, I'm like, oh my gosh, like that, first of all, just shows like the kind of like culture that we're, the waters we swim in. You know what I mean? Like, that's the crazy stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, that's the craziest thing ever. And I'm thinking to myself, I guess I'm just like, I'm sitting there thinking like, I mean, I guess those are crazy things, but in reality, those aren't, number one, the craziest things I've seen. And because the other side of it was, I was like, no, I didn't see any of those things. His response to me being like, no, I didn't see any of that stuff on this trip. I actually was like working with men in marriage. I'm like, I saw some men I obviously have some stories from being gone for 2 weeks. I mean, like working with men and then encountering like their emotions usually for the first time, or the fact that they're like, their eyes, like their brains light up to the fact that like they actually aren't treating their wives the way they need to be treated, all these things. And they're like, I mean, they start weeping. It's like a real revelatory moment for them. Right. You know what I mean? This is what we're working with every night, talking about marriage and family and stuff. And he's like, and his response, I know he was joking, so it's in super kindness and funny, but it's like, he goes, man, what a waste of a trip to Germany. And I was just like, wow, we have like really like, unless we're like delivering people from demons or we're like doing these things, we really have no value for, and what's funny about it is the last church that I was at with a good friend of ours, David Metzner, he was talking about the ordinary Christian life. And it's like, how much of our life is actually just lived in these ordinary moments, and God is still just as present. And it's not any less valuable, you know, spending time with our wives and our kids and our everyday doing the dishes and taking out the trash and doing these things that are these deep, profound, beautiful, supernatural moments that we miss. So literally having this conversation with him and then coming home.
Well, I think what you told me the next morning, right?
Yeah.
That when he said that, what I thought was beautiful is that you said that there was the most amazing thing that happened where husbands and wives turned back to each other. But nobody recognizes that as being a miracle.
No.
And that is that's great that you just got, you know.
Yeah, we had one dude that I was literally in a conversation with the night before, having this conversation with him about, you know, like, well, my wife, yeah, she's so upset at this, and this is what happened. We have this thing we have to go to, and she's all upset, and I gotta, you know, I'm telling her this is what we gotta do, blah, blah. I'm like, well, did you ever think about stopping and just asking her why she felt that way? And he was like, no, I've never done that before. It's like, so you've never really, like, she's feeling an emotion. It's a big emotion. You guys are dealing with something that's very ordinary, and she has a big emotion. It probably would be helpful just to go, why do you feel that way? Tell me more about that. And engage the emotion instead of just going, no, this is what we have to get done. And so he's like, I mean, the conversation went on for 45 minutes. We had like a long conversation about this. But he gets to put it into practice the next day and then shows up the next day to lunch and is like, hey, I wanted to let you know I asked the question. And that really works. Just so we're clear, she felt really, really loved when I was actually just processing with her why she was feeling it. And then we went back to the original decision that I knew I was like, we were going to make anyway, but she felt seen and heard and cared for.
And what a miracle when your heart is transformed and nobody sees it. Nobody really knows when that happens, but that changes generations.
Right. Nobody's getting on a platform and giving that testimony. You know what I mean? Like, nobody's like, and yesterday, just want you guys to know, I went home.
I turned towards my wife.
I asked my wife questions. Woo!
Like, I'll tell you who's celebrating that. I got some wives who are pretty happy about that story.
Right. But it's like,
this is the miracle of marriage and family. The miracle of doing it well, turning a heart towards another that changes generations. I just feel like, God, I wish we talked about that more. I wish we talked more about the legacy of marriage, that you Absolutely. Are affecting generations you will never see. You are affecting the lives of your grandchildren by simply turning your heart towards your spouse. I shouldn't use the word simple because it's not simple. That is profoundly difficult.
Right. I mean, that's Richard Rohr says it best. I've heard lots of people say it different ways, but Richard Rohr says it the most succinct way. And he says, whatever is not transformed will be transferred. Like whatever you don't pay the price for, and loads of people again say it different ways, but whatever price you aren't willing to pay in your lifetime with your spouse, you are asking your kids to go into that battle by themselves. You have told them effectively, I really am not willing to go through the struggle and the sacrifice of doing this well for your sake, because I actually have needs that are not being met. And I'd rather those needs be met than for you to be empowered and your kids to be empowered. So now I'm damning you to do the work that I could have done in my lifetime, but I just
was unwilling to do.
And it's just a willingness. There really is enough studies on this to show, especially specifically for men, you don't have to, there's not a lot of work involved. It really is kindness and staying. Like there really is no, like this isn't like a deeply profoundly spiritual move. This is like,
I feel like there's a lot of work involved.
Right. But most of the work, this is to me, most of the work, and okay, we can disagree. It's okay. Most of the work is staying. Like if you choose to stay engaged, even if it's frustrating, even if it's disappointing, even if it's hurtful. And again, we have to qualify all these things. We're not talking about abuse. If you're being physically abused in a relationship, go get help. Do not just stay in the house and go, I was told to stay in it because that's godly. That's not what we're saying. So please, I hope that's assumed, but I'm just throwing it out there.
Disclaimer.
Which is a full disclaimer. But for the most part, staying.
Okay.
Stay in it.
100% agree with you. Staying is so much harder than just staying. You put just in front of it.
Okay.
And you, that just is and encapsulates Absolutely. The human heart.
Absolutely.
Soul and the physical body.
Right. And Newsweek, I think we talked about this before. Newsweek did this article years ago, and I have it somewhere in the stacks of papers I have in my office. But there's a news article that they did on divorce and marriage. And the very last thing they said is like, basically this large percentage of marriages would course correct if the man simply decided not to leave. Like there's a degree to which even this isn't deeply spiritual. There is a part of just the physical nature of connectedness and not moving, not being willing to move and just stay. And I keep saying just stay, sorry. And staying that actually has profound impact in environments because I'm here.
Which I think is what people have done for generations and generations. Probably most people's, at least great grandparents could say, yes, we did that.
Yeah, we just stayed.
Yeah. And then I hear people say, oh, but they were miserable and sad and they'd be so much happier if they were divorced and blah, blah, blah. Although I can say, I don't know. There's always exceptions to every rule. So I'm sure someone's going to be like, well, I would disagree because I didn't have that experience. But most kids would say, I didn't really care how, quote unquote, happy my mom and dad were. What I cared is they were polite to one another and they were living in the same home married.
Right.
I mean, that brings stability to a child's life like nothing else. I remember, my mom and dad got reconciled for my fourth grade year. It was like the first year I did school well. I always thought I was kind of stupid. And fourth grade was the first year that all of a sudden the whiteboard, we had a whiteboard back then. And now they probably have a computer screen. I don't know. It made sense to me. I felt like my brain was open to learn because I didn't know this at the time, but looking back, it's like, oh, I wasn't so distracted by what was going on in my home life. I had a mom and a dad at home. That's all I knew.
Yeah.
And, I won't go into that too much, but there's something about the stability that brought to my life. Quite honestly, I don't remember.
Well, and again, we could go down that tangent in a million different ways.
Oh, yeah, we're going down a tangent, and you were supposed to be back on the
trip. But my point is, I think bringing it back to this point is based on my experience traveling and some of the stuff we're talking about now. Mm-hmm. Is number one, we said we don't consider this even a big miracle, like reconciliation of family, all these things. And I said it a bunch on this trip, which I feel like does need to be repeated several times. And it's a statement, but it's also a question. I really do wonder if for the last two decades that we've been giving ourselves to building movements, if we would have given ourselves to building marriages, how much further along our culture would be. Because mm-hmm. for the last two decades of sort of church culture, we've built movements, we've built these gigantic things. Now most of them imploded during COVID, which is crazy to see. And we got sent home to our marriages and our families, so it would have been nice to have those functional. But a lot of people gave so much into these movements, and a lot of them now, a few years later after COVID, are going through divorce, been divorced, going through all of their marriages are falling apart. And I'm just wondering, I just can't help but keep asking the body of Christ, church, friends, everyone, I wonder what it would have looked like if we gave all that energy and effort and finance and resource to focus on caring for marriages, how much further our culture would be along, how much stability our culture would have. Because we're talking a 20-year period where we really have been building some significant movements on the planet when it mm-hmm. comes to church culture. I mean, significant. And we are watching the fallout, documentaries be made, all sorts of stuff about the fallout of these things. I mean, the largest ones, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And we could have been giving that directly to family, to our kids. And I wonder what the stability would have looked like if we would have focused on those miracles instead of others. And
why don't we do that?
It's not as sexy. Number one, I just don't think it's as sexy. I mean, I preach this a ton, but it's like we go to the Lord's Prayer and we're like, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We're like, oh, kingdom, signs, wonders, miracles, healings, deliverance, all of these things. I mean, yeah, but none of that's happening in heaven, which is where he told us to look. It's not like there's healings and evangelism and preaching and worship leading happening in heaven. Those things are done because the fullness of who he is fully revealed in that place. So it's not like that's what's happening in heaven. Mm-hmm. So when he says, you know, on earth as it is in heaven, we have to look to heaven and go, well, what is actually happening? Which is there's a dad on the throne sitting next to a son who's a husband coming for a bride, which is family. So it's been perfect unity, perfect family, completely yielding to one another in sort of what we believe is the Trinity, yielding to one another in complete service to one another for all of eternity. That's what's happening. It's twofold. Number one, it ain't sexy. Like, that's not a sexy thing to be preaching because it's a lot of hard work.
Like, it's not sexy because chances are it's the area of your life, meaning the person preaching yep. or anyone who's got to say it, that feels the most broken.
Yeah, it's the least successful area of most of our lives. Or mm-hmm. where even if it is successful, even if we're like grinding it out because we're staying and we're working on it, that doesn't feel like success no. because we have a vision of what success should look like. We should be happy all the time and it should be perfect and blissful mm-hmm. at every turn. And it's like, well, that's not a real marriage. That's not a real connection. But I do think the other part, which just deserves mentioning mm-hmm. is that you get paid a lot of money to be a really charismatic voice in the church. Mm-hmm. So if you can preach, you've seen healings, you can prophesy, you do evangelism on the streets to some large degree, or even globally in crusades, like you're going to get a platform and there is lots of money and influence attached to that. And I think most people are looking for significance outside of their home instead of inside of their home. And when that change happens, when that exchange happens, that I'm looking for greater influence outside of the four walls of my house than I am inside of my own home with my own family, then I am willing to compromise in any way I need to, because I'm getting needs met outside the home that I'm not getting met inside of my home. I feel like I'm the same person, but out there they applaud me. So I'm going to go way more out there than I am in my own house. And I've said it a million times, like most people would rather fly 3,000 miles around the world instead of walk 30 feet across their living room. They'd rather preach to strangers than they would to lay hands on their own spouse, to actually deal and reconcile with the person in their home who knows them best.
Oh, that guts me. And it's so true. And I've lived it myself.
Yeah. And there's so much, and I get it. Like, I can say that. I feel like I can say this. It is so ego fulfilling to be applauded for being a good Christian.
Mm-hmm.
Really, if we're going to boil it down, no, that's what nobody wants and nobody, that's not it. And all the language. I get all the language. But there is a degree to which there is no version of this that doesn't fill your ego. There's no version of that doesn't, if you're not aware of it, it will consume you. That is for dang sure. Now, even if you're aware of it, it's still there.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's no way that me just like taking out the trash, when I walk back in from taking out the trash,
you're
going to be like, wow, babe, just, you know what? And you know what? For doing that, here's $50. Thank you so much for doing what you were supposed to do.
No, most of the times it's like, well, gee, so you remembered this one
day
time.
Late.
Yeah.
But my point is we're getting our ego filled in ways, honestly, have never been actually available in any time in human history prior to what, the last 50, 60 years. It's never even been available.
What do you mean?
Like, in the sense that with social media in general, large scale, like just media, I think media in general really is what changed it. You know what I mean? With the advent of some larger scale availability to television, radio, those sort of things. Like, prior to radio and television, which is only the last 100 years, right? Like, mm-hmm. we're dealing with the last 100, 120 years. I don't know when I should know these things. I don't know when the radio was invented and television came to be a public thing. And then we get, computers in our own room. Now we have access to media of all kinds. We weren't able to build a platform outside of the relevance of our own community. Mm-hmm. I love this saying. Martin Shaw says this all the time, and it freaking blows my mind every time he says it. He says, we were made to be famous for 5 miles. Mm-hmm. All people were. We're supposed to be famous for 5 miles. And the normal size of a tribe would have been 30 people. We were made to be famous for 5 miles and deeply influential to 30 people.
Mm.
If we are not famous for 5 miles and we aren't influential to 30, we will try to get 3 million to compensate for the 30 we don't have. And I'm like, dude, that we're watching that. So if I don't have real influence in my house because you're pushing against me, you've got brokenness, I've got brokenness, and we can't figure it out, instead of figuring it out with 1, 3, 5, I'll go figure it out with 5,000 who will actually applaud me and approve of me in ways you don't. And I will overcompensate that direction. And then the worst thing we do with that is we'll call it God.
Mm.
We'll call it a calling. We'll call it favor. That's even a worse phrase. We'll call it the favor of God on our lives. And we never have to go back and do this. Why? Because I'm doing this. Look how good I am. Look how good of a Christian I am. Look, everybody approves. Why don't you approve? Why don't you think I'm doing an amazing job? Don't you know the crusade I just did? Don't you know how many people just got saved, healed, delivered because I went and did this thing? And you're like, well, we're not connected. That's on you, not on me, because look at how good I'm doing with the Lord. And we're watching this happen all the time.
Wow.
And I'm like, man, we really have a lot to figure out when it comes to this, because now the miracle of marriage isn't even a miracle anymore. I mean, it was a sacrament in sort of Catholicism. This is the historic reality of this is a sacrament before God. It's not just a covenant. This is an offering to the Lord. Like, it's one thing to be like, this is a covenant, I have to stick in it. It's a whole different mindset when I'm like, this is a sacrament. It is an offering I'm bringing to the Lord. My relationship with you and our kids and the way that I build this house is an altar by which I offer a sacrifice that becomes incense to him. It's my form of worship. This is my worship right here. And it's like, well, no, my worship is the songs I wrote and everybody sings them. No, it's this platform. It's like, dude, that is the most BS I've ever watched. And we've seen that historically a ton. Talking to pastors and leaders who are like, have massive amounts of influence and are like, well, I can't really do what you're asking when it comes to marriage, because honestly, all these people would be really like screwed without me.
Well, and there's an entire culture out there who's telling you to run from your family. Oh, your family's hurt you. Your family's hard. You're not happy there. And applauding you as you're walking away from the one thing that can truly transform you. And it does transform you. I understand Jesus transforms us. But it needs to be embodied. And the embodiment of family and relationship is what grinds us down to the very marrow of who we are meant to be.
I love that word, embodied. You're right. That's the right word. Like that, I actually was preaching this on the road, but that's actually a better phrase. You should have preached it instead. It's such a better word because he says, let's make them in our own image, them in our. So it's the Trinitarian God making a one flesh image on earth. And then if you go to Malachi 2, it says that he made them one with a portion of his spirit, which means that both are three in one. So you have God who's three in one, and his image on earth is a married family, or is a married couple, one flesh, husband, wife, spirit, Malachi 2, Genesis 2. And it's actually, that's that language. We are the embodied image of God on earth. Because the embodied image of a Trinitarian God, we're like, yeah, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And we're like, yeah, yeah, yeah. Do you understand the amount of eternal submission that that unity requires? That's the image. That the image is that that mutual submission to one another that holds all of creation together. And then we are the embodied reality of that on earth when we're married and have kids. Like we are the embodiment of that image. We're the physical formation of his image on earth as a married couple. There's nothing more powerful on earth. There's literally no miracle on earth that you could do. Raising the dead is not a greater miracle than that.
Absolutely. Which
than
is,
that embodiment.
Which makes all the more reason for everything to come against it.
Well, yeah,
And it has to in some degree because it has to come at a cost. It does not have value if there is no cost. And I think there's no greater cost than family. And that once you're married, that's your spouse. But it does even include the family that you're born into. Mm-hmm. Nothing can be more triggering. I think even more triggering than you, my spouse, is my own immediate family.
Well, the one you spent so many years with prior to us ever meeting.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, that's where it all came. If I'm triggered by you, it is only because I was first triggered there. That's
family of origin stuff. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So maintaining a connection to those things, to maintaining a connection to that pain, not in a way to be a martyr, but in a way to go, what is it that I need refining in, that I need to embrace and understand about my own humanity and the humanity of the world in this situation? And I think that's the difference that you see in the, what I like to call the dangerous, well, I Clarissa Pinkola Estes is where this comes from. Not me, but I like to quote it. The dangerous old woman and the foolish old woman who you can quite easily identify in her 80s.
Yeah.
Less easier in her 40s and her 30s. It's very hard to identify. But those men and women who have something to carry in their 80s have carried the weight of family, relationship, hardship, heartache for many years to obtain those crowns they wear then.
It's interesting. I never saw it this way. And maybe it's wrong because we're both reading like all these books with this stuff language in it, but it's almost, it seems interesting because we've said dangerous old woman and wise old men. Like we want to raise up dangerous old woman and wise old men. Where what's interesting is it honestly is flipped in youth. It's actually wise young women and dangerous young men. And as that crosses in middle age, they almost carry the opposite as they cross through that sort of middle-aged yielding to the story you've been given and the place you've been given in the world and the family of origin that you were given and the family that you were building. It's like submitting yourself to that process and that work allows women end in the dangerous position, you know, where they're just... which I love that language.
And the dangerous old woman, the word danger comes from this concept that they would say, you stand in my danger.
Yep.
You stand in my protection.
Yep.
You stand in the place where I will not let harm come to you.
Right. And now look at that, like from a young, like a, mm-hmm. a like a father, you know what I mean? It's, mm-hmm. it doesn't play out the same way because it's right, feminine right, right. and masculine. But I love that idea of like, we actually yield to each other's strengths, both in youth and in old age.
Mm-hmm.
Like we, if we can yield to those, and that goes back to what we were just saying, like there's this crazy yieldedness to the image of a Trinity God is not just trying to describe the nature of God in the three capacities that are given to us in our lives and over created order. It really is that the image of mutual submission to one another for all of eternity that allows us to then embody that so that we can actually learn from one another in every season of our lives. Like we can actually do, you don't get that anywhere else in your life. Like there's no other version of this that you're going to get in your life. We can get it a taste of it in community. We can get a touch of it in community and friendship, mm-hmm. but in marriage, the actual physical embodiment of the image of God to yield to one another in and out of season for the mutual benefit of the common good
mm-hmm.
isn't where Christ is crucified in the midst of that, you know, mm-hmm. for the sake of his bride. Mm-hmm. There's this mutual submission to the part we play so that we can serve the greater good, which nobody's in service to the greater good anymore. Nobody that's where we've.
But it has to be done in awareness, I think.
Oh, absolutely.
Because I think so there's good. This, maybe old picture of submission where it's just you all lay down.
Yeah, doormat is not the same.
No.
Doormat's not the same.
I have to know what I'm giving you. And I have to know the cost that I paid to give it to you. And vice versa.
Absolutely.
I need to know what you paid to and what sacrifice you made to give me all of yourself.
To bring my full self into this space,
mm-hmm.
there's a cost for both right. of us, like you're saying. And if the more we can understand each other's stories,
right.
the more we know what it costs to bring us mm-hmm. together and what you're really yielding, which is the way I brought it up when I was traveling, was I was like, you know, I'd do all the whole message. I would go through this whole thing, you know, model is Jesus. This is why marriage, this, the whole thing.
Yeah.
And then I would go, okay, now we're going to Ephesians 5. And women are like, yay.
Our favorite verse.
That's my favorite. You know, no, nobody said that. And so I'd be like, all right, women, how many of you want to submit to your husbands? Like this scripture says, it says, wives, submit to your husbands. Who's excited? You know? And it's like, you usually get like, you know, the one lady who's been through it, you know, who's like been married for 40 years. And she's like, woo, you know? And you're like, thanks, lady.
We're the best Christian.
Yeah. I'm like, just kidding. Good job. You get to come up and preach this next time. Yeah. But what's, and I said, okay, now, you know, in context of what we're saying now, okay, now if I asked all of you in the room, who's excited to submit their entire lives to Jesus?
Mm.
Who's just excited to submit their lives to Jesus Christ fully and completely? And of course, yay! I'm like, why? And the main phrase that comes across is, I know. Twofold. He paid a price. He paid it with his life to love me well.
Mm.
And number two, he has my best interest in mind. Like he actually cares for what's best. Even if I can't see it, he ultimately knows what's best for me. And he's going to choose it. And he's going to sacrifice for me to get there.
So I can trust him.
So I can trust him. And when we do the work that we were just talking about, here's the cost of my body to put it in this room to yield to you. Mm-hmm. And likewise, the other way around, all of a sudden, we can now mutually submit to one another, which is what the verse says prior, that we can actually mutually do this and honor when it doesn't work, because mm-hmm. I know it's coming from a place of pain, hurt, trauma, whatever it is. I can see that, recognize it, honor it, and bring care to it instead of being frustrated that I'm not getting what I want.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, to me, that's the very definition of mutual submission. We yield to one another and care for one another when the other person sacrifices, regardless of what we get out of it.
Yeah, I think, to beat a dead horse with my own story, I think how that plays out for us
yeah.
because I'm a practical person. I hear people talk in big words and I think, okay, I love that language, but yeah. what does that mean practically right. for me on Tuesday at 3 o'clock?
Tuesday at 3 o'clock.
That's all. That's my day. Yeah. Always. Because what are you doing Tuesday at 3 o'clock? You know, anyway. For me, you know, in my story, coming from a broken home, feeling a deep sense of abandonment because there was a lot of, you know, different people come in and out of your life when you come mm-hmm. from a broken home, and that leaves you feeling, or left me feeling, abandoned, mm-hmm. unawarely abandoned.
Yeah.
So we get married. How ironic that I was going to marry a man who was going to travel and be very unavailable.
Yeah.
Not coincidentally. Why? Because I felt very familiar with a guy who was going to abandon me.
No.
Right? Even though this is the deepest source of my pain, that's what felt familiar to me. So I'm going to marry a guy who's really going to, and especially in the beginning of marriage, pretty emotionally unavailable, mm-hmm. traveled a lot.
Yes.
Perfect recipe for me to say I absolutely married the wrong person, because let me tell you, I was not happy and I was being triggered all the time.
Yep.
My needs were not being met and I felt lonely and abandoned. Of course, I didn't know that's what I was feeling. I just thought you were awful
yeah.
and not fulfilling any of my needs.
And we'll be straight. There is some degree to which that is true. I was not doing a good job. So there is a part of that.
You had to do that in order for me to be attracted to you.
Right.
Subconsciously.
That's what's so crazy about these things. Because you marry all of your triggers.
You do. And here's why. Because they're familiar.
Yeah, absolutely.
At least I knew what it felt like to be abandoned. So that felt safe. Yeah. What I didn't know is what it felt like to not be abandoned and what it felt like to be loved.
Wow.
That is scary territory. And you don't go to that place without intense understanding of your story and realization of who you are and why you do what you do.
Yeah.
You know? So I wasn't there.
No.
So now we have this cross section of you doing your job, living your life, being who you were, which really was this very successful for you minister,
yeah.
running a church. You were receiving a ton of success in your ministry professional life. Yeah. Everyone's applauding you. But for the thing that you're doing and getting all this applaud for, you were coming home to me and I was giving you the cold shoulder. I was upset and yeah. mad at you for doing it. Yeah. That is a recipe for disaster. And it was for a lot of years. Yeah. And you had no idea why that was hurting me.
Nope.
None at all. So it wasn't until we had, of course, I get this, I'm going to make this short now. I'm sorry. But
yeah,
this, you know, revelation of, oh, this is what I'm feeling. This is why I'm triggered. It's actually not Jake. I chose to marry him so I'd prove this true in my life. This is a huge open door of opportunity. I married the exact right person to help me walk through and encounter every wound I ever had. So now I need to crawl across the, you know, what feels like metaphorically crawling across broken glass. In all reality, it's pulling broken glass out of my knees. It's yep. not how it felt,
yeah.
you know, because it's very painful to face those facts, and knowing them does not change your heart position. It still hurts.
Yep.
But I was able to tell you that story.
Yep.
So now you were able to offer some measure of grace to me when I gave you the cold shoulder. That didn't mean it didn't hurt you anymore.
No.
And you didn't feel rejected in your own way by me, but you knew why. And you were able to go, okay, I mean, I'm putting words in your mouth, but, mm-hmm. And slowly over time, I was able to trust that even though you're seeing these broken, ugly parts of me, these places that I don't even like in myself, you're still going to love me, and receiving your love in that place is really painful.
Yeah.
But I think that's just sort of a synopsis of what you're saying, how that plays out in real life, day-to-day yeah. marriage.
Right. I think that what we want to be able to offer you guys listening to this podcast is, yeah, we have resources through the fight. We have fight weekends. We have the marriage 101. We have manhood 101. We have all of these things that we want to offer to you guys. And really the reason we want to be able to give you those is so you have tools to access what Nicci's talking about and what we are presenting even in this podcast, where there is, this is a divine opportunity. You will marry all of your triggers. You have to engage in that process regardless of the pain that you feel going through it, because that pain is a rebreaking of bones, metaphorically, that is going to set back in place the things that were set wrong through what you experienced as a child. Mm-hmm. There's loads of opportunity. And I tell men this all the time. The greatest privilege you will have in your whole life is to love one daughter who is God's, ultimately. One daughter. You will have the privilege of loving her well enough over a lifetime that the things she experienced that were broken could be healed by the time she goes to meet him. Mm. Like, that is the greatest privilege we have as men. Mm-hmm. And as women, to be able to do that for one another. I say men because men, I do believe, we've said it a million times, but you know, you have to go first. Like, you have to lead this. And
that's why I think knowing each other's story is so important, because right. Now when I can give you my story and you give me yours, now when you come home and I may be giving the cold shoulder, I'm
totally
feeling,
get it.
You know what it right. costs me when I show up. So if I show up only 5%, instead of looking at me and going, oh, she just gave me 5%. Did you see the whole world out there clapping 100% and you yeah. gave me 5%? You look at my 5% and you go, wow, that 5% cost you a lot.
Absolutely.
And there's a weightiness to the sacrifice and the laying down that we do, the submitting
yeah.
that we do to one another.
Yeah, and part of that is conversational. Like, there is a conversational nature to this, and then there's the walking out of it in practical reality in your own life. And what we're saying, like, we can wrap up this podcast with this thought, because we have kids that have to get places and stuff always.
And we still didn't get to what we wanted to.
Okay.
You guys.
We're going to get there.
We're going to get better.
But
the
point is that I think what we really want to encourage you to do is, on a weekly basis, you can actually take time. And after several men from who've been a part of Fight Weekend started doing this with their wives, is sitting down and just going, like, tell me something from your childhood that was hard for you or difficult for you. Or something that was really beautiful and something that you enjoyed, you know what I mean? And you kind of go back and forth. And there's way more real practical ways to do that, tools. You can get that stuff on our website, but like, to be able to take once a week, to be able to be really honest and vulnerable with the story you have so that your spouse can see where you're coming from is one of the best tools we can give you when it comes to marriage. There's a book called How We Love, which has the comfort cycle in it. There's Dan Allender's stuff, To Be Told, a book that he has. All of those things have really great tools, and really, like, if you really want to dig deep in it. But on a very practical level, if you can just once a week get enough time to just go, tell me something about growing up. Mm-hmm. Tell me something about you growing up that was hard for you, that was difficult. And being able to build, because what it's going to build is you're going to be able to know their story, but it will also, if you can contain that story, don't try to fix it. Don't try to figure it out. Do not try to fix. Do not try to figure out. Do not. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I don't know how we can make that any clearer. Just, that's not the goal. The goal is to be a good listener, mm-hmm. and to say, tell me more about that. Wow. How did that feel? Do you still feel that today? When do you feel that today? And being able to do that builds a history of trust, because I'm going to hold that for you. I'm not going to try to figure it out. I'm not going to try to fix it for you. I'm just going to contain it and be a witness to your story, mm-hmm. so that it is seen and heard maybe for the first time.
And then in those daily interactions that we bump
yep.
shoulders
yep.
and that if we are able to, I think it's just been so helpful to realize, oh, this is so much bigger than our relationship.
Right.
Number one, you have a whole story of your right. own hurts and your wounds and your pains that you brought to right. the table. And that's not to go, oh, you have a whole, like, God, you brought all this crap into our marriage. Yep. It's to go, wow.
Wow.
So the fact that you showed up today is a beautiful miracle. Right. And I can celebrate that with you. Just these little small victories. It's the 5%. So you're giving 5%.
That's right.
your spouses. Hopefully you're showing up with 100%, right? Because sometimes our 100%, we're giving 100%, but when our spouse looks at us, it looks like 5%.
And I think what we want to say, specifically connected to what we were talking about in this podcast, is the fact that that is a gigantic freaking miracle.
Yeah.
Like, that is the miracle. To go like, oh, you didn't see any healings, you didn't see this, like, any demons, you didn't see this or that or this other thing. All those are awesome. Love all that stuff. That's great. This is the miracle. Like, this is the same. This is beyond those miracles. To show up with a 5%, to be able to hold someone's story, to be able to care for someone in kindness when you're not getting your needs met. When you're able to do that, that is more Christ. That is more Trinitarian image bearing in your life than anything else you will do from a platform, from behind the scenes, or anywhere else on the mission field. I don't care where you are. That this is the miracle that requires the image bearing capacity of a human being to look like Jesus, to look like Father God, to look like Holy Spirit when it actually matters generationally and building legacy inheritance for children that we will never see, stories we will never get to be a part of, but we had a privilege of laying the foundation for.
I love it. It's beautiful.